It's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Cédric Villani at IST to give this very special IST lecture. So before he starts his talk, let me introduce him, although I think probably for most of you he doesn't need any introduction. He's currently a professor in Lyon and at the same time the director of the Institut Henri Poincaré, major institute in mathematics in Paris. Cédric finished his PhD in 98 at the age of 25, and he became a professor 2 years later at the age of 27, at an age when most of us is still doing his PhD, but already at that time, Cédric was working on his first book. I know because I happened to know him back in 99 in Atlanta, and he was a visiting professor already at that time at Georgia Tech. His office was next to my office, and he was working on his first book. Since then, he wrote already many, many books. And of course, he's well known for several of his major results. His first major result was about the convergence of the Boltzmann, convergence to equilibrium of the Boltzmann equation in a quantitative way. His other main result was more recent on Landau damping. And also, he more recently did many, many works on optimal transportation and the connection between geometry and optimal transportation. In general, he is working in connections between geometry, partial differential equations, and probability, and probably many, many other things. And of course, he has many, many major distinctions. Let me not list all of them, but just a few. So he was an invited speaker at the ICM International Congress of Mathematics in 2006. He got the Poincaré Prize of the International Association of Mathematical Physics in 2009. He got the Fermat Prize at the same year. And his main prize, the major distinction, he got the Fields Medal, which is equivalent to the Nobel Prize in Mathematics in 2010. So I think that's all. And now we should be looking forward to his talk. So.
Okay, thank you very much. Everybody hear me? Yes, it's a great pleasure to be here. It's always a pleasure when I can be back in Vienna. I first visited this city many years ago because my aunt used to live here at some point. Then I came back for professional reasons. And on top of that, it's a great pleasure to always appreciate the fine pastries that you find here around this place. It's a great pleasure also to find again the fine mathematics that there is here. As Laszlo Erdős mentioned, we know each other for a long time, and at the same period, we were part of exciting developments and some exciting analysis group in Georgia Tech, Atlanta. Today will be a lecture in which we shall encounter a number of different subjects. Each of them will be the opportunity for a few historical remarks and the opportunity to show that mathematics is not just something that is used to solve technical problems, but also part of our culture and our history. And we also think about the way that mathematics is being done. And in particular, I will speak, among other things, of my own research. Let us start, because in this audience there is a number of non-mathematicians, let us start with some reflections about mathematics as a field. I like to compare the mathematician to this lady. Why not? This is a picture of the Lady of Shalott. It's a poem by Alfred Lord Tennyson. It's famous in the English culture. And in the legend, this poor lady is imprisoned because of some curse. This is from the times of King Arthur and so on. And the curse is that she's not allowed to look at the world directly with her eyes. She can always see the reality through the mirror, which you see there, only the reflection. To some respect, mathematician in some respect resembles this. In his or her daily work, he's not allowed to do experiment or to test the reality directly, but only to look at the reflection, which is like the mathematical equations. Mathematics, of course, is something abstract, but always is inspired from the real world, always is a reflection of the real world and the real laws. And it's a very efficient way to do certain things. Not immediate is the advantage seen, but on the long run it can be extremely efficient. In the legend, in The Lady of Shalott, things are rather tragic. At some point she sees Lancelot passing by here, and he's so handsome that she cannot resist, and she looks at him directly through the window, and then the curse, of course, makes her die, and her body drifts along the river that you see. It's very tragic. And many people wonder if there is some hidden meaning in this poem of Tennyson. And I like to think that this is the allegory of the mathematician. So, here are some around our mathematician. We put here some objects which are well known to mathematicians. Some formulas, some equations, some curves, some graphics, some distributions of things. All of them abstract things, abstract stuff, but all of them reflecting reality. And some of them that we can see in many instances. One of the things that make mathematics so powerful is that an abstract thing can be incarnated in many different experiments or different phenomena. And sometimes a single curve or a single formula you will see appear in many different worlds, many different equations, many different experiments. Henri Poincaré liked to say that mathematics is the art to give the same name to different things. And we'll see examples of that in the coming lecture. Other things that we should say about mathematics is that, contrary to certain misconceptions, it's a very vivid and moving field, moving very fast. We had discussion over lunch with other people about the pace at which mathematics evolves. There was some disagreement about whether we should count the same mathematical discoveries of the old days in which giant leaps were made suddenly by one individual, and those of today, which sometimes appear more incremental. But everybody had to agree that the volume of mathematics which is being made and produced increases exponentially fast with the time, and that there are many more mathematicians living nowadays than mathematicians from the past centuries altogether combined. And that there is more mathematics being written nowadays than mathematics being written ever in the past. So it's a field which is growing very fast. Hundreds of thousands of new theorems are proven every year. Then, of course, among these theorems, some make history, some do not make much noise, some are very famous immediately, and there are some mathematical problems open, some that mathematicians would kill for being able to prove, or almost. If you ask mathematicians which is the most important problem to solve, the answer will depend from mathematician to mathematician. But if you ask which is the most famous mathematical problem to solve, probably they will answer Riemann hypothesis. Okay, here I put some fancy words, deepest scientific mystery of our times. And this is one example of a problem which was formulated more than 100 years ago, which is still defying the attempts of mathematicians, and which is at the same time simple to state, impossible to solve and which has fascinated the best mathematicians decade after decade since it was stated. What is this problem? Well, it's about a certain function called the zeta function of Riemann, and you see the formula here down. Don't worry about the formula if you don't like them. Just it's a function that if you give it a certain number s, it will give you a certain number. And for instance, if s is equal to 2, the number is the sum of the inverse of all the squares of all the integers. And it's related to prime numbers in the second formula up there, p stands for prime. Prime number is a number that you cannot divide. For instance, 7, you cannot divide it by 2, or you can, but it will not be an integer, and so on. And this zeta function of Riemann, it makes sense for any complex number. Complex number, they have a real and an imaginary part. And we may ask, as for many functions, which are the values of the complex number so that this function gives the result 0? Why not? Well, Riemann had reasons for considering this problem. But he conjectured that all these places, all these numbers for which the function is 0, were either some integers or all lying on a certain line in the complex plane. So it's like you are looking at the where are located certain points in the plane and you find all of them on a certain line. You will say, why don't we check, compute them? Okay, we can do this, but there are infinitely many, my friends. We can only compute a finite number of them. But still, let's do it. Even since the birth of computers, people have tried to compute these numbers. Alan Turing, for instance, father of modern computing, made these programs to compute the zeros of the Riemann function. And he found that they were all aligned, those that he found. Since then, it has been computed, I think, thousands of billions of them. Maybe, let's see, will correct me if I'm wrong. But this is this order of magnitude. And they are all aligned. But you know, mathematics is the only field of mathematical thought in which thousand billions of clues going in the same direction are not enough to consider that something is proven. You know, in any other theory, if you have an economic theory, if it is satisfied 1,000 times, it's okay. It's more than enough to make it accepted. Most of the time, it's not even satisfied 3 times, you know. But in mathematics, billions of times is not enough. This is the real distinction between mathematics and other sciences. Clues are not enough. You need the real proof, and proof is logical argumentation leaving no place for error, even not one chance out of 1 billion. Which is the stake behind the Riemann hypothesis? Well, it's related to prime numbers. And to cut a long story short, all the more that I know extremely little of the story, it's a field in itself, if the Riemann hypothesis is true, then it says something about the way prime numbers are distributed among numbers. And it will say something like they are kind of randomly distributed in a way which we understand very well. We understand the statistics of the distributions of these prime numbers looking at a distance. Not where they are exactly, but statistically how many they are here and there. Now, about a decade ago, journalists in The Guardian wanted to make a fancy paper about mathematical problems and came out with the idea that if it was solved, it could bring disaster for internet. Wow, that's a title. You see this and say, wow, how is it possible? It's not clear when you're a mathematician why that would be true. Then you can reconstruct the reasoning. If it's related to the distribution of prime numbers, and prime numbers, for those who know, they are so important in cryptography, because dividing a huge number as a product of two prime numbers has been for a very long time used as a key method for encryption, guaranteeing security of internet transactions and whatever. And then the idea is that if we solve the Riemann hypothesis, then the pirates, the cyber pirates, they can find the prime numbers easily. and then factorize and then break the code. Of course, if you understand what I said a few moments ago, you can see that this is nonsense. Because if the Riemann hypothesis is true, it will mean that prime numbers are randomly distributed in a way that we understand. Now, my friends, what use would it be to find the prime numbers if we know that they are randomly distributed? Not much. It will not help much. And of course, this is completely wrong, all the more that nowadays they don't use the prime numbers any longer. They turn to other internet, turn to other recipes. But we know that that's not the reason why we love the Riemann hypothesis. Riemann hypothesis mathematicians love because they know it is a old problem related to fundamental problems of understanding where the prime numbers are. We also know that it's related to many other problems in mathematics, in science in general. For instance, it is known that there is some apparent connection between the spacings between these points, these places where the zero, where the zeta function vanishes, and the levels of energy of what you could call a random atom. Ratzlow is an expert, by the way, on these issues. Take an atom, but not made of real protons and neutrons as in a real world. The most chaotic, the most random atom that you can imagine, made of the interaction of many, many different particles, abstract particles, and ask about their levels of energy. And you will find with extreme precision a very strong correlation between these levels of energy and the spacings of the zeros of the Riemann function. Why is that so? Why would there be a connection between the world of prime numbers and the world of quantum mechanics? That's the thing that fascinates mathematicians, and this, the idea that if we understand this, we'll have the key to progress in many areas of science. And as usual, if you work on the abstract thing, there can be many consequences. By the way, in a novel which appeared a few months ago, the author imagines that somehow a famous mathematician has solved the Riemann hypothesis in England, and some alien civilization immediately sends out one of theirs to take place of that mathematician, kill everybody who has been in contact with the proof to make sure that the humans don't know the proof, because otherwise it will be the start of raising mankind to a new level of technology that would be dangerous for the galaxy. Riemann not only worked on this problem. For instance, we call Riemannian geometry the current discipline of non-Euclidean geometry, a world in which units of length may change from place to place, and in which things are not straight like they are in the geometry that we learn in high school. In this world, we cannot speak of a line between two points, but we can still speak of the shortest path, as in real world, by the way. You know, to go from Paris to Vienna, it doesn't make sense to talk of a straight line because the Earth is round, but we can talk of the shortest path to go from one point to the other. Riemann gave us the basic axioms that we still use to this day about how to compute these things, how to compute the shortest path, for instance, the geodesics, which are the equations and how we should think of this. And also he gave us the key object to understand these geodesics. Understand does not mean write the equations and computing. Understand means finding some simple rules which give you the clue to understand the properties. And in particular, Riemann, following the path of Gauss, his master, contributed with this notion of curvature. Curvature is still to this day the key ingredient used by mathematicians to quantify how distorted is a geometry, how non-flat it is. In one of these notions of curvature, it quantifies if these curves, these geodesics, tend to get closer or further apart compared with lines in the plane. For instance, this here is a representation of hyperbolic geometry. Due to the artist Escher, imagine here that each of these fish has in fact the same length. This is because units of length change from place to place. In this hyperbolic geometry, the space here is in fact infinite. You see, as you are getting closer to the boundary, the unit of length becomes shorter and shorter, and you never reach the boundary in a way. This geometry has negative curvature. And if you draw lines in this geometry or shortest paths, they will diverge from each other faster than lines diverge from each other in the plane. All the more faster that you see the distance between this point, for instance, and that point is very, very, very large, because the units of length become so small when you approach the boundary. This geometry was just a game at the beginning of the 19th century, later was found essential, for instance, to understand the behavior of some physical systems. And opposite to this geometry is the world of positive curvature, such as the sphere, good old sphere. These are shortest paths. And look here. Imagine starting from here, I look at these paths. These are like lines. These are shortest paths. And you see, they cross once at the North Pole, say. They will cross a second time at the South Pole. You see two lines in the plane. If they cross once, they will never meet again. It's farewell. But on the sphere, they cross once and they will meet another time. It's an illustration of the fact that in positive curvature, the distances grow slower than in the plane. A related property is the fact that triangles in the negative curvature look skinny. For instance, the sum of the angles here is less than the usual 180 degrees in the plane. On the contrary, on the sphere, triangles look fat. Here, we have three right angles, so it's a sum of 270 degrees. And it's not the highest that one can do. When I make this kind of lectures in high schools, I always take a moment to let the kids find out and work out which is the maximum sum of the angles that one can find in positive geometry. And this is even more than 270 degrees. I will not do it here because I'm sure you already got the answer. Now, curvature gives rise to beautiful shapes. And here, this picture was taken in a special place called the Museum of Hyperbolic Coral Reef in Dublin. In this museum, you can see this kind of mathematical shapes looking like coral, in fact made with a simple mathematical rule, negative curvature, constant negative curvature. So in fact the same geometry as the hyperbolic space which we saw before with the fish. It looks like organic, right? But it comes from just a mathematical rule. Hyperbolic knitting. It's a bit of a game, an art. It is the same geometry that you find on this other shape, which was exhibited a few years ago at the Fondation Cartier for Contemporary Art in Paris. This one is called the pseudosphere. It has this point here. And if you look at the geometry here on a tiny bit of the surface, it will be exactly the same as the geometry here, even though that is not apparent. Relations between the surfaces, the angles, etc., will be the same. And again, the same as that you will have on this kind of, it's a kind of spinning top. It appears, it's a mathematical shape appearing in some problem of mathematical physics. This image got an award in digital image. And you see, if you take this, it looks like it's made of many different units, a bit like accordion. Each of these units, again, has the very same geometry as this shape or that shape. Constant negative curvature. Only difference is there are these singularities here, this kind of crests. Apart from this, it's the same. See what I was telling about Poincaré, giving the same name to different things. Here we have a perfect example. Where we see three different shapes, a geometer will see constant negative curvature. In fact, they are the same from the geometric point of view. Now, Riemann was a mathematician and worked on this not to do art, but to do mathematics for curiosity. And his work also inspired other mathematicians who built on it. One of the important contributions was by Gregorio Ricci Curbastro at the beginning of the 20th century in Italy. And that's one part of course, of the game in science, what you do, other people can use and build on this and so on. And sometimes it also goes outside of your particular science, can be inspiring for other sciences. And it was a big shock when a few years after Ricci came out with his notion of curvature, derived from that of Riemann, Einstein discovered, through thinking and conversations with a mathematical friend of his, that the Ricci curvature was the cornerstone, mathematical cornerstone of his theory of general relativity. And this is typical. Ideas in mathematics will often go in other sciences. And then there will be also a movement back because the new problems in physics will inspire new directions in mathematics. As nowadays, general relativity is a thriving area also in mathematics. And sometimes it will also go into the technology. Now, general relativity, it's one of the giant theories of the 20th century, one of the most famous, but it has almost no applications except one. And it's not bad, it's GPS. Without general relativity, no GPS, because you cannot incorporate the information with high enough precision, information that you get from satellites. So in each of the GPS, which are used by hundreds of millions of people all around the world, there is a bit of Einstein, there is a bit of Riemann, there is a bit of Ricci, and the trace of all of those people, mathematicians and engineers who contributed to this. Those people did not know the applications that they would be made of this. And at the other end, people using this technology usually have no idea of all the work that has been incorporated in there. That's part of science and technology, and it's beautiful in a way. Riemann was also interested in understanding the singularities precisely. When is there a shock? When is there some discontinuity in the properties of a fluid? Like here, this supersonic plane generates some shock around. It's like, you know, we hear a bang when there is a supersonic plane near us. And how is it? Why is that? This is an interesting mathematical problem. This is Kalashnikov. We also hear a bang when a Kalashnikov shoots. And you may not like Kalashnikov, but still, this is a very nice geometric pattern that we would like to understand. And Riemann was the first to try and understand this from mathematical point of view. Now it's a whole community trying to understand shocks in fluid mechanics. Actually, Riemann was interested in everything. And it's very, very impressive when you contrast the shortness of his lifespan. I mean, this guy was dead younger than I am nowadays. And the list of deep concepts that he gave us and which are used by mathematicians all around the world. This makes Riemann a very inspiring figure, not just as a mathematician, but just as a human being. And believe it or not, a few years ago, I had discussion with a very famous rock singer who told me that from time to time, she goes and on the grave of Riemann for meditation, for inspiration. This also is important to keep in mind. Scientists, because of their role in exploring the unknown and so on, can be inspiring for people, all kinds of people, even those who are not scientists at all. Also, I like graves. So, this is a picture of Ludwig Boltzmann, one of my mathematical heroes. I made my PhD thesis on his equation. It is an equation which is associated to many words that are important for mathematicians and physicists. In particular, the rise of the notion of entropy from a mathematical point of view, associated with disorder, a notion which also has inspired artists, writers, and many people. This tomb is in Vienna. This is Central Friedhof, Vienna. Here is the formula for the entropy. S is K log W. It was not written in this precise form by Boltzmann, but this is a way to rephrase the definition that Boltzmann gave, the general definition. And it's famous in the community that there is this tomb in Vienna with the formula in there. S is K log W. So in 2006, when I was invited in a conference in Vienna celebrating the work of Boltzmann 100 years after his tragic death, I knew that I had to pay a visit to the Central Friedhof and pay tribute to Boltzmann. You know, he was almost part of the family after I had spent so many years working on his equation. Now I arrive in Central Friedhof, and of course there is this huge cemetery. I don't know what to do. Nobody in sight, no map, whatever. I don't know where the grave of Boltzmann is. Bad. So there were some people, and I look for help, sitting around. I asked, you know, if I can find somewhere a map of this cemetery where there are some famous people. And they told me, no, no map. Who are you looking for? And I said proudly, you know, Boltzmann, thinking maybe this guy has heard about Boltzmann. And he looked at me in the eye, and said very precisely, S is K log W. So I knew he was my friend. And he took me to the grave, and he even took the picture. And that the destiny of mathematical formulas one day become the password, you know, between people in the know, in cemeteries. Why is Boltzmann so famous, and why is this formula so important? This formula is related to nature of matter and the atomistic nature of matter. We now know, and it's common, we learn this in school when we are young kids, that matter is made of atoms, tiny, tiny, that we cannot observe. This is an act of faith. Little children, they buy this, no problem. Okay, okay, even though they never saw an atom, they buy this. But this is a rather recent discovery. It is only about one century ago, about 100 years ago, that it became accepted by the majority of scientists that matter was made of atoms. Before that, it was called the atomic hypothesis. Boltzmann and Maxwell were making these key contributions in around 1870, 1860, 1870, at a time in which there was no way to prove that matter was made of atoms or things like this. But it was very imaginative. They kept the idea, went on, and said, let's imagine that matter is made of many, many molecules, and that a gas is made of many, many molecules going at very, very fast pace. They were not the first ones to have this idea, but they were the first ones to show deep consequences about this, and to show how you can explain certain properties of matter with this idea in mind. This is a weird idea if you think about it. Look, the air in this room is very still. If I were to associate a mathematical number to the air around us, what would come to mind immediately would be zero. No wind, everything still, nothing. And we know that on the contrary, it is made of billions of billions of particles going with crazy speed in all directions, hitting us, hitting each other. It's amazing, a change of point of view. And they had this idea that to understand this, you need a microscopic model telling you what will happen to the colliding particles, like a giant billiard game, you know, understand the rules of these molecules, and not try to follow each particle individually, because you would be lost. But try to study this as a statistical problem, which is a proportion of particles whose velocity is in this direction, which is a proportion of particles' velocity in that direction, and so on. And this was the vision developed by Maxwell and Boltzmann. So here I have these statistics, and imagine that this is the object you work on when you want to develop and understand the atomistic consequences of the atomistic nature of matter. It was also related to the idea of randomness and chance. And this is a fascinating area of science, the idea that you can control, master chance in a way. It starts with the law of large numbers, 1700, comes way after the first mathematical contributions in geometry or algebra that goes back to ancient times. Law of large numbers is the idea that even if when you toss a coin, it's impossible to predict if it will be head or tail, if you toss a coin 1,000 or 1,000,000 times, you can predict the statistical outcome. Looks paradoxical that you can predict the result of many, many experiments, uncorrelated, even though you cannot predict the result of one experiment. And that's a basic paradigm. Around 1730, in this field, mathematician Abraham de Moivre, who was a French guy emigrated to UK to escape religious persecution at the time, had made this discovery of the Gaussian law, what would later be called Gaussian law. And it would be better to call it the Moivrian law or the Laplacian law. But anyway, it is this kind of bell-shaped curve which appears systematically also in these many experiments, in these coin-tossing experiments. When you toss a coin in the air 1,000,000 times, roughly speaking, half of the time it will be heads, half of the time it will be tails, if it's a regular coin. And you can ask which is the error that will be made. In proportion, the error will be most of the time a small error, and this corresponds to the bulk of this curve. And rarely it will be a large error, and this corresponds to the tails. And the profile is this bell-shaped curve. Let me skip Buffon and go directly to Laplace. About 1810, Laplace proves the intuition of de Moivre and proves at the same time that it is a general law, not just something that is related to coin tossing or to a particular experiment, but something that you observe every time you do a number of uncorrelated experiments, which are repeated always the same. The law of errors. And there is a typical width associated with this Gaussian curve, as it is called now, which is like the inverse of the square root of the number of experiments. The precision becomes better if you make many experiments, but it cannot be much better. It has to be at best precision like 1/√ of the number. This was a very difficult theorem at the time. A few decades later, people remarked that not only does it apply to mathematical experiments, you can also find it in real life. For instance, in statistics related to sociology. And Ketterle observes that, for instance, if you look at the statistics of criminology, for instance, you will find Gaussian statistics also. Francis Galton, at the end of the 19th century, remarks that you can also find it in nature. For instance, looking at the distribution of the sizes of people within a species of animals, for instance. Here is what Galton says. I know of scarcely anything so apt to impress the imagination as a wonderful form of cosmic order expressed by the law of frequency of error. The law would have been personified by the Greeks and deified if they had known of it. It reigns with serenity and in complete self-effacement amidst the wildest confusion. The huger the mob and the greater the apparent anarchy, the more perfect is its sway. It is a supreme law of unreason. This is a nice formula. mathematicians love this. When a certain pattern appears in different contexts, and you can, when you can make a connection in the abstract world between various problems. And here, it was no exception. So the contribution of Boltzmann takes place in the rise of physics of the energy all throughout the 19th century, thermodynamics, but also in the context of this understanding of probability theory. And Boltzmann is the first one to give to the entropy a probabilistic interpretation. So here is Boltzmann's formula, general. If you are given a certain system of which you only have a partial information, like the statistical distribution, not the complete information of where all the particles are, but a partial information. Look at all the possibilities, call it W, like where all the particles can be. And this may be a huge number. Take its logarithm, which is like the size of this number. Call this a disorder. It means the total amount of information which you cannot retrieve. So the disorder, in a way. As it is a nice definition, but if you're an engineer, you will say, okay, that's good, but how do I compute it in my gas? And Boltzmann gives you the answer. Take the statistics of the velocities and the position of the gas, this distribution, the statistical distribution, and then you can compute the entropy with a certain formula, minus integral of f log f. If you're an engineer, you can compute it. It gives a result that you can exploit, that you can measure, that you can see and use in experiments. This was a huge progress. Boltzmann at the same time emphasized on entropy as a phenomenon which drives the experiments and drives the physical laws. In particular, he establishes that entropy has a tendency to increase spontaneously through the banging of particles on each other. For instance, take this experiment in which you have a gas which is put in a half box and there is a wall separating the two halves of the box. What happens if we remove the wall at the beginning of the experiment? Well, we know the gas will invade the whole box. And if we are from the vacuum, it will seem like the gas is aspired, sucked in, you know. And we like to think that there is like a force, that the vacuum is attracting the particles. What Boltzmann tells us is you should not think of this as a force exerted by the vacuum. It's in fact that the system will want to go to a state which is more disordered. Because collisions will increase the entropy. And of course, there is much more unknown if the gas, instead of being in just one half of the box, will be in the whole box, distributed anywhere. You don't know where it is. This is more disordered, and this is the state that the gas will prefer because of statistics. And that's the contribution of Boltzmann, the power of statistics to explain physical experiments. Boltzmann, for his proof, use these beautiful objects called partial differential equations. All of these formulas, you don't need to understand them to understand the talk, but they all are meaningful for mathematicians who are specialized in them. They all represent a system coming from physics or from some mathematical problem, like here, the Boltzmann equation describing the evolution of the statistics of a gas in a box. I told you it's impossible to track down one particle in the gas. But the statistics of many particles we can track down. It is as in this coin experiment. For one coin we don't know the outcome, but for many mini coin tossings we can know. It is as in demographics, you know. If you take one individual, we cannot predict if that individual will have kids, will marry, will move, etc. But at the level of a whole country, you can predict very clearly over the years how the population will evolve, taking into account the birth rate, the death rate, immigration rate, etc. Boltzmann equation is the same, gives you the evolution of the statistics of particles. All these equations have meanings. For instance, this one will govern, for instance, galaxies. You know, if you want to know if our galaxy will one day collide the Andromeda galaxy, as astronomers say, this is the equation you have to solve. They say it will arrive, yes, but not tomorrow, like in a few billion years. Here, the equation here on the contrary is the Schrödinger equation. It's for atoms, the behavior of one atom. How does it go? That's the foundation of quantum mechanics. These equations are the foundation of fluid mechanics. It's much more complicated in certain respects than the behavior of one quantum particle. Problems like turbulence. I just saw some beautiful experiments being made here in the fluid mechanics team here about understanding the onset of turbulence in a fluid, what happens when the fluid seems to be agitated. It's such a complicated problem. These equations of fluid mechanics, they are used very often nowadays, every day, to predict the weather, to make special effects in the movies, and many other possibilities. It's one of the great technologies of mankind. And as a mathematician, I became specialized in this thing in my years of PhD, understand the Boltzmann equation. Remember what I said, it's reflection. Not making experiments on the gas, but working on the formula to understand effects and features about it. It doesn't look very sexy, the Boltzmann equation, for the non-experts here. And I have to say, when I first saw my would-be PhD director, PhD advisor, write down the equation, for me, I thought maybe it's still time to change subjects. And still, in the end, I spent years of my... I really fell in love with the equation. It says everything. You look at it first, you say, wow, and then you say, wow, so interesting. I really fell in love with the equation and spent years of my life with it. Now, Boltzmann predicted that in a classical gas, the entropy always goes up and up. And to do this, he used the equation we just saw and his definition of entropy, combining the two, to prove that the rate of increase of the entropy is always positive, and made this computation, which I show here, in a particular simplified case. From this, many things can occur. For instance, natural thinking that was in the head of Boltzmann. Let us try and figure out which will be the final outcome of the gas. Entropy will increase and increase. Up to where? Which is the maximum state of the entropy? Maybe that is the final state. So let's find out which is the maximum of entropy. Solve this is a mathematical problem, and what you will find? Ha! Again, the same Gaussian distribution as before. That law of errors that Galton told us was the supreme law of unreason. See again, that's what mathematicians love. Finding again the same function as we saw occurring in the problem of coin tossing, now it's a problem of gas. And there we are happy. Now, the problem seems to be solved. But that's just the beginning. Okay, maybe it increases to Gaussian distribution. Entropy goes up. But how fast? That's one of the questions I worked for years in my PhD. In relation, for instance, to a conjecture stated by the late Carlo Cercignani about relating the rate of increase of entropy to the value of the entropy. It's a mathematical question, but it's related to a physical problem, the approach of equilibrium. Okay, so this is what I was doing for years and so on. And you see from these examples that the work of a physicist can inspire mathematical works. It's kind of the reverse of what I told you with Riemann, we were going from mathematics to physics. Here we are going from physics to mathematics. It always goes in all directions. And the applications of the notion of entropy were very numerous. People like Einstein, like Jean Perrin, like Marcotte, like Mouchkovsky, like Shannon, father of information theory, they all read the work of Boltzmann and were inspired by the notion of entropy. And nowadays, Boltzmann equation is also used in the industry. Whenever you have a gas, it may be useful to solve the equation and so forth. Boltzmann died without even being sure that his theory would be validated by experiments. Nowadays, not only it is validated, but it is used every day by engineers all around the world. Again, many, many years after the theory was laid down. In this example, as in the previous one, there was a long time between the theory and the application. But sometimes there is a very short time, and sometimes the theory comes for solving a problem. And that's the case for the third story that I will tell about, that of Leonid Kantorovich. Leonid Kantorovich was a great Russian scientist, a mathematician, specialist of functional analysis, as we say, some rather abstract part of mathematics, but also specialist of very concrete problems. He worked on railroad transport, on atomic bomb, even on taxi fares, how to devise a way such that the taxi fares are efficient and fair. He was one of the first experts in numeric approximation in his country, and so on. He was a devout, he was a sincere communist, and he thought that it was important to have a centralized economy and work to establish what would be the best, the most efficient way to do this. His masterpiece is his works in mathematical economy, which earned him the Nobel Prize in Economics in 1975. So he's one of the very rare mathematicians who actually got the Nobel Prize. Kantorovich is one of the heroes of an amazing novel, which I think is only available in English, Red Plenty by Francis Burford, in which the author examines how the ideas of Kantorovich and more generally planning the economy can be used to make a certain reading of the history of the Soviet economy, from the times in which it was rising, like very fast in the 50s, to the time when it was collapsing, and how, in a way, the mathematical formulas interact with the human behavior and all the kinds of problems that make it that what you find is great in the mathematical world sometimes does not apply to the real world. Kantorovich had his scientific life completely transformed by plywood. Plywood is not very sexy a priori, this thing, you know. And plywood is, you make several slices of wood of different density, for instance. You put them together to obtain some kind of material. What does it have to do with mathematics? Well, one day these experts from the plywood industry, these people in charge of a plywood industry, they came to see him. They had to have, you know, great results for the plan, and they asked him about optimizing their outcome. Professor Kantorovich, we cut this wood from this forest, that wood from that forest. We transport it here and here. We have a sewing machine that can do this. This other new machine can do that, etc. There are many possibilities. Should we put half of our production here, or quarter, or 20%, whatever? How to tune all the parameters so that our production is best? And Kantorovich did not know the answer, but he thought about it. Kantorovich was very precocious, you know. Let's see. I was kind enough to mention that I had the chance to be professor at an early age in France, but Kantorovich had his full position at university at age 22. And, you know, wonder kid and so on. And Kantorovich thought about it and came up with a general solution. Linear programming. Linear programming is basis for fun exercises at high school. I don't know if in this country you do this still in high school, I hope, because it is fun, in which you have inequalities constraining the system and you want to find the optimal solution for a certain criterion, maybe half this quantity plus twice this quantity should be optimal. And you have a certain number of inequalities, like the production should never be more than this level, or the combined level of this and that should never be above that, all of them given by linear inequalities. And when you have three constraints, for instance, you can solve this geometrically by hand. When you have 10, it's more difficult. Nowadays, in real problems coming from industry, it can be 1,000, it can be 100,000 of constraints. And there is no talk about solving it geometrically. You need the theory to solve it. You need algorithms, you need computers, and so on. And Kantorovich was one of the first to develop this theory of solving the linear programming problems, which since then have become one of the most successful methods of optimization used all throughout the industry. An old problem posed by Monge in France at the end of the 18th century about the optimal allocation theory. Here's the problem. Imagine you have good produced at points x1, x2, x3, x4, and you want to take it to places where it will be consumed, at places y1, y2, y3, y4. Can be anything. Can be anything. In my book on the subject, as a good French guy, I imagine these are croissants that you produce in bakeries, and you have to take them to cafes where they will be eaten for the breakfast by the consumers, whatever. If you are in this cafe, you don't care if the croissant comes from this bakery or that bakery, assuming they are all good, but you need to have the right amount of croissant to satisfy everybody. So it's not a problem, it's a problem of where to send the production in such a way that this is the least expensive possible, that the process of transport is costs as little energy as possible. There are experts in this problem also in this room. And in the problem as stated by Monge, okay, he asked also for practical way of solving this. And Kantorovich, with his theory, could set up algorithms that would solve this problem. Also, he came out with this beautiful formula. Nowadays, it's called the Kantorovich duality, and on the book which I wrote on the subject, is the first chapter, Kantorovich duality. Let me explain the formula and comment. The minimum cost, this is the sum of all the costs for transporting the good from production to consumption. The minimal cost is like the maximum of something. And that something, let's call it a profit. It's like this guy comes, he has this company that moves things around, and he tells you, let me make this transport problem for you. I will buy the material from you from the consumption site. I will buy it at the production, sell it to the consumers. I take care of the transport. Just let us fix the prices for buying it from the factories and for selling it to the places where it be consumed. And these here are the prices that they will set up. Prices for buying, prices for selling, and so that is the total cost, the total profit that the guy will make. The guy wants to make sure that he's not a crook, so he will say, okay, whenever the difference of prices will never be more than the cost of transport from this place to that place. And what the theorem of Kantorovich says, and it's a real theorem, is that if that guy is clever, the total profit will be as much as the minimum cost that you can hope. Why is this interesting? First, you see here, it becomes an economic problem. I talked about prices, I talked about profit. You understand with these kind of problems why it's conceivable that Kantorovich was awarded Nobel Prize in economics, because this is a theory about prices in the end. Also, it's interesting to note something which I did not evoke so far. Sometimes the mathematics can come at odds with problems from politics, from ideology, and one has to be aware that building up a rational theory of prices in Soviet Russia, as Kantorovich was trying to do, was simply endangering his life. For much less than that, you could be sent to Gulag or just shot, because it was considered subversive. Price was coming with an ideology in those times, and this is a kind of theorem that even if it's a mathematical theorem, under no circumstances you would be allowed to talk about in public. And the Russian mathematicians, they had to use all kinds of, you know, turnarounds to evoke these kind of results. Nowadays, not only can we tell about them in public, but it's used all the time. See, I took from some economics tutorial these examples about many problems in economics which are solved by using the techniques of Kantorovich, linear programming. All these problems, however different they are, come down, boil down to the same mathematical formula and are solved by a number of algorithms through the ideas of Kantorovich and his peers. Okay, so far, and I told you the three stories I wanted to tell you, and you may say, okay, this is not up to the level of expectation from a French lecturer, there's no construction, there are three different stories with some links, but we would expect better than that. Now, let's remedy this problem. Of course, it's true I told about three different stories with three heroes living at different times, different places, working on different problems. There was this geometry problem, curvature, the fat triangles. There was the gas problem, the entropy, the disorder. There was the economic problem, minimizing the cost in the transport, etc. Different techniques, different fields. It came as a surprise when it was discovered around 2000, at the end of the 90s, beginning of 2000, by some mathematicians, and I was part of this group, that these three problems, different as they may seem, they are in fact strongly related, intimately related. We love links of this kind because this allows you to make progress on all the areas at the same time. Progress in the geometry, progress in the notion of entropy, progress in the optimization problem. It did not come in a smooth way. It's nothing like one day this guy thinks, oh, I have this idea. There is a relation between this and that. Usually it comes through randomness. Usually it comes from encountering people and so on. I stole from some blog this interesting image contrasting the public perception of science. Get a challenge, think, read science, do science, get Nobel Prize or something like this. Contrasting it to the real process, familiar to anybody who has done a bit of research, accept the challenge, do challenge, instrument breaks, what the hell, continue, not quite as expected, amazing results, turn out to be crap, continue again, what the hell is going on, whatever, thinking makes sense, no it doesn't, funny, oh this makes sense, and then you figure out somebody did it 50 years ago. Still, out of this big mess, from time to time emerges something. That's a kind of pattern familiar to people doing research, and it's part of the fun. But if we want to do a real accurate picture like this, this should be just one loop of a picture in which everybody corresponds to this loop, and all these loops are interpenetrating. Because you encounter this guy, have this conversation, this other guy, that conversation, you do the mistakes, the two of you, etc., and so on. And this story is no exception. The understanding of the relations between the three fields came through accidents, came through mistakes, and came through meeting people. The two most important for me were Felix Otto, whom I met in France in 1998 and then came to visit in Santa Barbara in 99. And John Lott, whom I met in Berkeley 2004. This is Berkeley. It's a beautiful Berkeley campus, always sunny, and people always smiling. And this is the famously ugly mathematics building in Berkeley, Evans Hall. When they know you are in math, they say, you're so lucky you don't see the Evans building. And when you are in there, you realize it's not only ugly, it's not functional, because You know, you never meet people. It's this vertical layer organization, so that if you are in this level, you don't meet the people at the level below or upstairs. And I was a young guy visiting professor there at the Miller Institute in this building. I knew there were all these great mathematicians around, never meeting them. It was good conditions, you know. I had no teaching, no administrative duty, nothing to do except attending a lunch once every week with other people from the institute and talking to them. And for this, I was paid 3 times my French salary. Still not so happy, because not meeting people until John Lott came. He was not from the university, so he was not absorbed in the all the obligations of the other people. He was visiting Mathematical Sciences Research Institute just nearby, uphill from there. Had read our paper, and he came to my office. I read your paper with Felix Otto about entropy and the transport, and it's great, and with this we'll solve many problems of geometry and so on, and I was amazed. And this encounter was a real turn into my career. It is starting from there that I really went into Riemannian geometry. Before that, I was looking at it from a distance, but after this encounter, I went into it really. And what we built on, I will describe, and that will be the end. I will call it the lazy gas experiment. That's how I present it in my book. It's another way to think of curvature. I told you about curvature at the beginning. And I told you about curvature like triangles are fat, so it's about angles, you know, geometric, purely geometric problem. But now, let's imagine that Boltzmann comes out of the grave and you want to explain to him what curvature is, but not with the geometric intuition, with the intuition of gas and entropy. Just to give him the flavor, the point of view, the intuition. Not the theorem, but the intuition. And that's how you could explain it. It came out through the works I did with Otto, the works of Cordero, Macken, and Schmuckenschläger, my work with Lott, and at the same time, Karl Theodor Sturm was also in Bonn, was also working on the same problem with a slightly complementary approach. As usual, this was made in a very international way, with people, I mean, not two. There are no two people in this list who belong to the same laboratory. They were all from different institutions. Very often in mathematics is the case. A laboratory is not really the place in which you publish together, but it's a place in which you discuss. And collaboration can be with anybody else in the world. So here is the experiment. You want to know if you live in a world which is curved positively. Take a gas, and the gas has some statistical distribution at the beginning of the experiment. And it's not like in the Boltzmann case in which you let particles free to do whatever they want. It's another kind of experiment in which you impose that the configuration of the gas is a certain distribution after time one, say 1 minute. So let the gas go from this configuration to that configuration. But the gas is lazy, and so he will do it in a way that minimizes the energy. Like in the Kantorovich problem, you know? Energy for a gas is kinetic energy. So let the gas minimize the amount of effort which is spent. And all through this process, let us measure the entropy with a good formula of Boltzmann. If the curve of the entropy is always concave like this, with the bump facing up, this means you are in a space of positive curvature. It's equivalent. See, we love this. There's a problem of geometry, a problem of disorder, a problem of minimization, and they are all connected in this. Can we understand a little bit why it's connected? Yes, we can. Remember, positive curvature, I told you, is like the sphere. On the sphere, if you have two lines, they start diverging from each other and then they meet again. Like they start from North Pole, they meet again at South Pole. So they start by diverging and then converging. Imagine our gas here tries to go through shortest path. Typically, the trajectories will first diverge and then converge, and we see it, diverging, converging. But if the trajectories of particles diverge, the gas will spread, you know, because more space is available. Remember from the experiment in the box, the highest entropy corresponds to the spreading of the gas all throughout the box, because there's more possibilities. So in between, we expect the gas is more spread, and that corresponds to higher entropy. This gives you a flavor of the connection. Now, I will stop here, but this was just the start of the reflection. Once the connection is established, many things can occur. And in particular, with this connection, we solved problems of geometry using the entropy. Problems which had been stated by geometers and seemed to be out of reach by using ideas of looking at how the entropy evolves and so on, and for which we still don't have any other way to prove them. Actually, many researchers started to work in this area. Some of them in this room also, by the way. Many works that for me, it's very hard to follow because they appear so fast. A few years ago, I wrote this book, 2008. It's about 1,000 pages thick. It uses this a lot. It describes about optimal transport and so on. Since then, the progress in this particular area has been so fast that if I wanted to be as exhaustive as before and do it again, it would have to be double the size of the book that I wrote. And again, this meeting of ideas led to developments that I myself could not foresee. We know very well in mathematics that meeting of people gives new ideas, that meeting of ideas is through meeting of people, and there are institutions around the world who are specially devoted to this, making mathematicians meet so that they can have new ideas. The institute that I run in Paris is precisely for that purpose. It's a meeting place for mathematicians around the world working on this subject, that subject. Every year, hundreds of mathematicians come for certain topics to discuss, to get ideas. We decided in advance which would be the subjects with some people organizing, but we have no idea of the outcome. And that's part of the pleasure of mathematics. Thank you.